Impressed to see how they're evolving.
Oh, yeah, I definitely want to see what they decide to run today. They do have Betsy in that middle lane. And I want to echo what Tabs was saying. If Gambit can get ahead in the laning phase and try keep Fnatic from roaming, try keep Fnatic from moving around the lanes, that might work out. The fan is behind Huni today, that is for sure. But Nidalee's away from Diamond. Rumble taken away from Fnatic's top laner.
Yeah, two target bans here. Of course, Huni yesterday against SK were fantastic on Rumble. And the same can be said about Diamond. The last few times where he got to play this Nidalee. So two comfort picks, first of all. No mid lane bans yet. Normally we see a lot of mid laners being banned against Forbidden. But in this case here, there might be a lot of things open suddenly. And then Xerath, we know he loves to play it. He even first picks Xerath if it's open, because he's just that confident in his ability to play it.
Well, not taken off the table from Cabo Shard. We've seen Huni run it once before and it left a lot to be desired. He performs a lot better on those aggressive champions, but Lissandra still up. Rengar now taken off the table. This is, of course, the first rematch here in the Spring Split, Deficio. Fnatic have already beaten Gambit once, and it was using a Rumble Olaf composition with Zed to round that out a little while ago. Zed's still available if Fnatic want to go that route.
Yeah, and that, of course, was before Gambit got into their winning streak here on 4 games in a row. So there's definitely a big improvement for them and a big difference in the team. We see Coach Leviathan as well, just behind Cabo Shard here. He's really come into this team from week two, honestly, and just made sure everyone knew what to do in the game. No Xerath first pick, instead Zed. Same as yesterday for Forbidden against SK Gaming.
Yeah, but it was comboed with that Rumble. And as we saw in that highlight clip just a moment ago, there was some early kills, early teleports from Fnatic's members that helped them get the lead against SK and allow them to snowball that game.
And we really saw how Fnatic, it's all about the team play. 5-on-5 together, you sacrifice your lane if it means you can get a kill for your teammate. And they play around it so well. Only problem they did have was like closing out the game a little bit because they didn't split push at first. Trying to go as 5 and then SK managed to stall. But let's see what they do today.
Yeah, you do see Gambit with a very smart lock-in. That Morgana, Cabo Shard's used it in the top lane to great success. And yesterday, Rainover had a brilliant game on Rek'Sai. You can also swap that Morgana to support if they want to go that route.
Or even so mid lane, it's a triple flex pick and go to so many different lanes for Gambit. But yeah, Cabo Shard has really been the guy to play it in the top lane. Two different builds, cooldown reduction, utility to help his team, or full nuke AP-focused Morgana as well from him. And I actually like this Rek'Sai because what we saw yesterday, when people pick Jarvan, you can take Rek'Sai and actually outduel him early on, and then you can apply a lot of pressure on the map. That's what Rainover did against SK. Now Gambit makes sure, despite the Nidalee being banned, they still have a great early game jungler for Diamond who can really make some plays, and one-on-one Rainover if he finds him.
So we'll see what they decide to do. It is a Maokai and Graves locked in. Steel back, not going to get his traditional core key despite it being up and available. And Huni going to be playing that tank. I prefer him on the Mage Champions. I think he performs a little better. The damage dealers, we'll see how he performs on this front line.
Yeah, again, and also, sorry, notice what Fnatic, it's already shown double physical carries and a tank top laner, meaning going into late game for Gambit, if they do have a tank top, and if it goes to like a Morgana support, you can stack a lot of armor there and it becomes very hard for Fnatic to take you down. But later we get into the game itself. If it's going to be Morgana top lane, it won't really matter too much for Fnatic because nobody will be fully stacking that armor.
So we'll find out what Gambit decides to do. Betsy going to be playing his traditional assassin in the middle lane. And Pinoy once again on Kalista.
Yeah, we've seen this before here. When Gambit takes Morgana early, they go for Kalista later because now you have that Black Shield to protect her as well, so she can play really aggressive. Because Pinoy, he goes for that Blade of the Ruined King built into Hurricane, so very attack speed focused, which basically means he has to stay in the fight for longer to get the same amount of damage, so he doesn't have that extra AD from like a BF sword. And that's where the Black Shield really comes in and helps him play really, really aggressive in these fights.
Two games played for Pinoy on that Kalista. He's gone 7-5-12. Not the greatest of stats. Tends to have a strong laning phase, but the one thing I'm concerned about, if he doesn't get to a QSS relatively soon, could get popped quickly, fairly immobile, once Zed jumps at him. Maokai can lock him down as well. And Pinoy's opted into this.
Yeah,
we'll need to see how his positioning plays out.
And also with the likes of Anya and Leona open for Yellow Star, so for Fnatic side, if Maokai engages on to this Kalista, you'll just follow up with the stun from a support, and he's gonna die, and he cannot waste a QSS because of the Zed ulti either. But it won't be any Annie or Leona for Yellow Star. So instead, just relying on that Maokai, which normally is a fantastic pick against the likes of Kalista. Because if you can lock her down, she's, of course, very squishy as an AD carry. then you can get a kill. But that's where the Black Shield from Cabo Shard is going to make wonders for Gambit.
Well, Fnatic have got a similar play style to what they've done previously against Gambit with that Olaf in the jungle again. Reinova's returning to the only European jungle that's found success, but that is purely AD focused. Yeah. A lot of importance on this early game for Fnatic.
Very AD focused. And also Fnatic again, a bit like yesterday, not running any hard engage because Maokai is fairly short range on his W. So for him, he's going to have flash ready if he wants to like really dive onto the backline of Gambit to start a fight. Olaf, of course, is going to ghost him with the axes here. So you're not really looking for this, oh, we catch you out of position and boom, you're just going to die instantly. Instead, it's just very, very Bruiser heavy. Olaf, Graves, of course, one of the most tanky AD carries we do have. And then the Zed, so Skirmish, Bruiser focused from Fnatic, but also a strong 5-on-5 itself. And of course, for Gambit side here, very, very squishy composition coming in.
Well, we are going to see that cannon to round out Gambit. So as far as team fighting goes, they've got a lot of utility, a lot of mobility as well. All of the champions can move quite efficiently without their Morgana, but that's quite inventive for Gambit.
It's what we often see from Gambit, actually. They run very squishy comps, but with a lot of mobility and a lot of focus on being able to one-on-one people left and right, and a lot of pick potential. So when you look like at the Ahri coming in with the Rek'Sai together, that's a very strong 2-on-2 skirmish from Gambit's side, where they can play aggressive around that mid lane if they want to with Betsy. But again, they always have that problem. If you get caught out and you are this squishy, you will get popped instantly and suddenly you are in a disadvantage going into the fight, where someone from Fnatic's side, because Zed, of course, can dash around with the shadows, you have the Maokai, we have the Olaf, who you don't really want to catch out because they're going to be so tanky already. So a little bit more room for error for them. But for Gambit's side, they have just a lot of damage coming in here, and they can really blow off some targets if they get in a straight team fight.
Yeah, Gambit are going to be looking for those engages to happen. I definitely want to see how these lanes play out. Yesterday, Gambit showed a great 2v2 lane, and Diamond's synergy with Cabo Shard yesterday was fantastic with that Nidalee plus Renekton. You're about to see those team comps on your screen. Remember, Fnatic are 1-0 up against Gambit. And Gambit, however, they're on a four-game winning streak. Hit us up on Twitter, #FMCWin, #GMBWin. There's the flags, the banners, the logos. As we load onto the ref, that is Fnatic versus Gambit. You can hear how excited this crowd is. Deficio, I'm looking forward to this impressive-looking Gambit to see how well they can play today against one of the league's top teams.
They've done a fantastic job beating teams who you would sometimes consider worse, except maybe the Elements game where Gambit just had a fantastic comeback. And they've actually just, again, looking... They look great, and they look better for every week they play, which is really the highlight for them, how they've turned around this season. And now against Fnatic, who's probably sitting... Will we consider them the best team? No, SK still, I mean, dead even, we can say after what
Second
we saw
best.
Yesterday. I think we'd say SK and Fnatic are very, very even, but yeah, definitely the top two teams in the ELCS. If Gambit can beat Fnatic here, they're really showing this winning streak is for real.
Well, that's definitely the case. Gambit have been steadily improving. You heard that clip from Diamond earlier in the day, and he said, after the losing streak, we've got some wins on the board, now we want to set ourselves up for the winning streak, a huge winning streak. #13-5 the dream, according to some Gambit fans on Reddit.
And we see the same here for Eddie. He did, as he did yesterday on Annie, he started Boots, now doing the same on Morgana. If he's in a lane swap, it's great because it allows him to roam around. Obviously, he's going to get less gold. But if he gets in that 2-on-2 lane, suddenly you don't have that extra combat stat. And that's where the Boots doesn't really pay off for you. So I want to see how he plays with it.
Talking about his opposite number, Yellow Star's Thresh yesterday was particularly good. He landed some clutch death sentences around the towers, but it was really Reinova's Rek'Sai that was the main initiating tool. So I need to see how impactful Yellowstar is going to be when Pinoy can hop, Betsy can dash, Diamond can tunnel. There's a lot of mobility, and you've got the Black Shield if anyone's at risk.
And that's the thing here. Both comms not really having a clear way to start team fights, because again, the Black Shield is going to block the Maokai from just jumping onto one target and locking them down. And meanwhile, for Gambit's side, you're going to rely on maybe landing a charm, a flash coming in from Diamond to knock up a target, then follow up with the cannon ulti to stun someone. That's how maybe you started. Or you need to land the one binding or the hook from the two supports. So no real clear way for both teams to start it. So it's going to be a lot about objectives and vision control now. And then you get a good fight. And they're invading straight in this blue buff.
Huni and Reinova, with 75% of the public vote in their favor, are going to go for an early invade. The lane swap plays into their favor because of the duo of Fnatic being down. However, Blue will at least slow the process a little.
This is very, very smart, though, and a bit of a greedy play from Diamond himself. If you don't start on the same side where your dual lane is, you risk this happening where Fnatic can then take their own buff and rush straight toward the blue. Unless you start the blue itself, which Diamond didn't do. He was actually doing walls first. That's again why he now loses it. And I don't think he can get to their blue in time because now we have the recall from Raynova. He's going to run there with Smite ready. So it's going to be three buffs from or four Fnatic. Let's see, Diamond, he's trying. It is here as well. But notice how Yellowstar and Huni, they follow Raynova.
Let's see if Febiven decides to spin around. Yesterday, Fnatic got some early kills in the jungle. And it was Febiven Zed that was leading the way. We do some members
ooh, they're coming Gambit. In.
The Dark Binding's going to connect on Huni. Look for those smites. Diamond's still trying to get the buff. It's Diamond that's caught up. The flash, the death sentence. Diamond gets blue buff, but he's going to give up first blood to Raynova. I don't think that was worth it. And Raynova does eventually get his third buff as well.
Yeah, just really well played early game from Fnatic. Seeing the lane swap and then just going straight for that blue buff here, it obviously gives them two options. Either you can go and dive the cannon if, let's say Gambit has started on the top side with Diamond here, then suddenly you just had a free blue buff and then you could dive Cannon after. But as soon as they spotted him there, it was fairly easy for them to do three, four buffs even with the kill onto Diamond. They're gonna get everything early on.
So something that we have been saying since the changes the 2015 season is that three buffs isn't the end of the world. Raynova actually gets exhausted. Eddie is going to go in, tries to get the lockdown. Here comes Pinoy to help out. That's going to be a double buff given to Pinoy. That is a massive turnaround. They're turning onto Yellowstar. He gets caught up by Diamond. All of a sudden, it's Fnatic that are the greedy ones. Gambit reply. Double buffs on Pinoy and a kill to Diamond. That is a huge swing in favor of Gambit.
Yeah, it looked so good for Fnatic beforehand. Almost, well, actually got the four buffs, but then caught behind enemy lines and Gambit collapsing on them, getting double for the AD carry. No freeze up here, so Huni has been able to get some XP. Level 3 for himself. Actually goes for Cabo Shot as well. So both the top laners getting some decent farm, but Cabo Shot is ahead because he's actually been left on his own all the time. And now Pinoy, he's looking for some
look how many spears
here.
There are. He's got Rend, he's got red buff. Huni is scared, does need to flash away. Pinoy unable to actually proc that, but that's going to be a difficult lane if Huni wants to stick around.
This is really massive for Gambit because, again, Cabo Shot, he's just been sitting in that bot lane. After Fnatic took the blue buff, they didn't go and try and kill him. Instead, they went back to their own blue buff, so tried to deny Diamond some farm, and therefore left this cannon on his own. He's a squishy target. He would be easy to dive normally. Not anymore. He's already level 4 or 5. And 26 CS to 11 from Huni.
Well, I'd want to echo what Tabs was saying in our pregame, how if Gambit can get off to a strong lane, if they can get off to a good early game, it can help them contain Fnatic's roams, contain Fnatic's movement around the map. They've got Pinoy with double buffs up top. They've got Cabo Shard with a CS and a level advantage. And yes, we haven't seen much of Betsy yet, but he's staying relevant, and he's going to have support soon. And see what happens to Cabo Shard. He's flayed backwards. He's going to be able to just rush away. This is a very, very good start for Gambit.
Yeah, for sure. Especially because Diamond managed to get some revenge on Raynova and Fnatic for taking all his buffs. Got to kill himself as well, and an assist. So he's actually looking fine. XP is not a problem. Remember, it's the camps that really matter, not the buffs itself. Febiven jumping on Betsy. Small level advantage for him.
Yeah, Febiven hitting that ultimate mark.
Betsy will get it.
Goes
now.
Aggressive instantly and actually burns the exhaust. Just the threat of death mark was enough for Betsy to use that summoner spell. So Febiven got a small advantage in the mid lane. He needs to make it capitalize. Oh! Yellowstar stealing the crab from Diamond. As we catch another glimpse, Betsy now going in. Deathmark used to dodge the charm and going to get out safely. Betsy continues to engage. Fairly smart play from Febiven.
Yeah, Betsy actually tried to bait him into a bad fight here because Diamond was coming from the river. But due to Fnatic spotting him as Yellowstar was stealing away that juicy goal for himself, Febiven just ulted and then backed away for himself. I'm not sure if he actually dodged the charm with his ulti or not.
I think he did.
Probably did, yeah. So just Betsy trying to set up a little bait. Didn't work for him instead. Just some more farm. And often again what you see is if Ahri falls behind in the lane to Zed, she goes for Armguard. It's one of her first items, like Codex into Armguard and then a fairly early Hourglass. So she at least can stay even in the lane and not get all in by the Zed.
Well, we'll see how this works out for them. Gambit going to start stabilizing these laning phases. We do see Huni moving up to that top lane to try to deal with Pinoy as best he can. 30 CS to 44, still down, but definitely not out of it. Does have his teleport available. And we do see Cabo Shard continuing to accelerate. You touched on the item builds that we could see. Maybe you're going for that arm guard
There we go.
For both mid and top lane, actually, for Gambit.
Keep in mind, Fnatic is close to only physical damage. Yes, there's the Maokai some true damage on the Olaf, but the two main carries is going to be physical damage. So getting early outlasts from Gambit is going to mean they can actually take some good fights in the mid game. Kennen as well, some of the recent buffs he's gotten has become stronger and stronger in terms of the mid game itself, especially with his ulti. And the fact he can actually max his W now after the change, so it does damage to everyone in Kennen's ulti, which is really, really strong.
So we'll expand on that in a moment. This is 5.3. Fnatic signaling their intent to control Diamond. Another jungle invade. The entirety of this opening match, Fnatic have put emphasis on Diamond's buffs. It cost them at red, but that's another steal for them.
And it was, of course, Diamond doing so well the last few games for Gambit, always setting up kills for his solo laners. Now it's really been denied quite a bit. Again, not in terms of XP too much, more just the fact he never gets to have a buff or give it over to Betsy either. And we just see Fnatic with a bit of a power play. You have to teleport in top lane and four guys on the bottom side, so you will always be in a numbers advantage when you go for that buff.
Definitely the case. And as you were mentioning, just before that previous buff battle, we are on 5.3. Kennen did have some tweaks to his ultimate, going to hit everybody within the range as opposed to random targets. And very important, like you mentioned, the W damage applied to everybody.
Inside the ulti.
Inside the ulti range.
Basically, that means you can max it in the lane itself, so it's ready for the first dragon fight. And that's going to be a massive power spike for him compared to the Kennen where he used to max Q beforehand and only have the damage on one target. It was like eating a small binding, not really doing too much. No tower's been taken down in this lane swap, so it's been very different from what we normally see, because again, there's been so much focus on denying buffs from the junglers and not really diving or stopping any of the top laners from farming, really.
Well, we'll see how this works out for them. Cabochard still with a small advantage, 20 CS over Huni. Febivin not going to take the bait against Betsy. Betsy's around 10 or 15 down. But dealing with that early aggression of Febivin.
Yeah, well, okay, they're losing the mid lane from Gambit's side. Pinoy managed to get a lot of farm on Kalista. He dodged the Graves early, which would have been a very tough lane for him. And of course, Cabochard have been winning as well in terms of the top laner. So Gambit actually been winning out of this lane swap with the farm on both Pinoy and Cabochard. And let's see Reynov. He's spotted here by a ward. It's already pinged. So as you see, Gambit can now start the dragon with Reynov being stuck in the top lane.
Eddie and Pinoy, the wave is pushing very, very heavily against them. We'll see if they get caught out. Three members of Fnatic top. And as you touched on, Deficio, information is key. Gambit going to secure an uncontested, safe dragon at absolutely no cost. That is a great ward in the top lane.
Yeah.
A fairly non-traditional ward, but it works out really well. It's about to time out, and Gambit take full advantage.
And even better for Gambit, because they were sitting in the middle of the lane, you have to, of course, respect the lantern from a Thresh. So you needed that ward really far back to really see if anyone was coming, and that's why they placed it there. So good, good ward in the top side, making sure they stay safe, get them the dragon as well. And I made this comment yesterday about how Gambit, they don't really care about early dragons unless it's for free. That's basically from Eddie himself talking about how, yeah, you know what, we want farm, we want kills instead. But if we see someone on the top side and we don't have to buy any pink walls to take a dragon, we will go and get it, like Gambit just did here.
So very well played. What we did see was that farm alarm from Diamond used to actually secure his own red buff. We did catch a glimpse of Fnatic members moving into the jungle and clearing out the tunnels, but Gambit able to defend. You know, this is something we have seen from Gambit over the course of their winning games, the winning streak rather. Their laning phase in their early game tends to be relatively strong. They've got very high skilled players, but they tend to lose some focus or some shot calling in the mid game. So I want to see how they use this very mobile high damage comp once we start seeing more pressure on towers and once we start seeing roams. Diamond, it's going to work again on that synergy with Cabochard.
It's actually really been a good thing for Gambit with Cabochard and Diamond together. Cabochard is one of the best top laners in terms of pure laning phase. And then, of course, when Diamond can come down and snowball him, he can really start taking over the games. We've seen it so many times. Notice they can spot him in the bush here. They know Huni's sitting there. Saw a sapling. They're just going to go all in.
Well, Cabochard's looking forward. That's an instant flash from Huni. He's stunned. He's knocked up. The tree is getting chopped. Cabochard continues to lay down the auto attacks, but it's the Prey Seeker that seeks the honeypot and takes him down. Gambit with another kill.
Another kill, and just a nice little setup with the lane gank from Diamond, knowing you had enough damage and CC to lock down a Maokai. Actually going for Righteous Glory from the side of Huni, so no Rod of Ages for him, which means even less magic damage from Fnatic later in the game. going for that mobility instead to really help out the Olaf pick as well from Reignover. Get in there, get into the back line of Gambit.
So Fnatic have this team comp that's heavily stacked in dealing physical damage. We felt the early game, the laning phase, may be quite integral, because if their opponents get those hourglasses, get that armor stacked up, it could be very difficult for them to win team fights. So Fnatic got to be very careful with how much they give away to their opponents.
And the only good thing for Fnatic is there's no tank on the side of Gambit, except for maybe the Rek'Sai, who will be stacking armor for sure, but that's one target. The backline itself, you don't really get any armor items on the likes of an AD carry. And obviously for the two mages here, yes, you get an hourglass, but that's going to be it. It's going to make it hard for Febben to find a target. But in terms of like pure armor stacking, because there's so many squishy members of Gambit, we're not going to hit those 250, 300 numbers, which you would see with a full tank.
So we'll see how Fnatic manages to deal with that. Yellow Star gets charmed by Vetsy. Tremor Sense will reveal Reignover's position. Diamond's going to smite that one away. Again, Fnatic really, really trying to control the blue buff from the jungle of Gambit.
Yeah, all they're doing here is denying that blue buff from Betsy. Because very important in the Ahri and Zed matchup is Ahri, once she gets arm guard and then a blue buff, she can actually start spamming abilities and she can push the Zed back and suddenly actually catch up and farm for Betsy's side. But he keeps losing that buff here, meaning that Febiven has a fairly easy lane and he can keep his lead.
And it's showing 15 CS at this point. We do see Edward Soul Shackles is available. Gonna set his sights on Steelback, going to be moving in. Instant teleport from Huni. Is that going to complete? Yes, it is.
Oh, Edward. Ulti.
Oh, that is so smart. Pinoy using the Fate's Call so that Eddie can keep his flash. Much shorter cooldown. And they get out clean. So, Hourglass is completed. Merc Treads picked up for Diamond on that farm alarm. Reignover looking for Cabochard. This could get messy. We do see the slicing maelstrom, but you cannot stun a Ragnarok Olaf. Cabochard going to throw that Hourglass down. Going to stay alive. Flashes out. Now Diamond's looking. Prey Seeker goes out. He's used the tunnel already. Diamond not able to flash. Cabochard chasing. Prey Seeker hit the W. One or two more hit attacks needed. Not going to secure the kill. Is this going to get them in trouble though? Febiven.
More people are coming here. Two mid laners moving down.
Cabochard's going to solo. Take the tot. 100 HP left, less than actually. Febiven's now chasing in. Knockup is not going to work. Death cap, rather death mark, not even needed. They've thrown that down into Huni, but here comes Betsy now. This has turned into an extremely extended fight. Betsy's on the board. 1-0-1. Who else is around? No. Duo lane's going to help out. And heavens to Betsy, he's going to back away from that fight. But 1-0-1, got a kill in the row.
Yeah, two kills actually here for Fnatic in that fight. Cabochard and Diamond ended up going down. Only one kill going over to Febiven with the roam. Back up to this dual lane. Pinoy's really had a good time because the lane's open. Oh, they're going in.
Flash, Flay, Deathbox does not connect. And Eddie, thanks to saving the flash earlier, is able to flash out towards safety. But successful gank nonetheless. However, Yellowstar did use his own stuff.
And we just saw that one-on-one before between Reignover and Cabochard. That's really going to be the big deal for Fnatic when you have this Olaf who can get locked down by all the CC from Gambit. He's going to be a big deal in this game. Febiven obviously saving ulti. Diamond is doing his best here to try and save Cabochard by knocking up the Zed first. But as soon as he can actually just dash around him, get the first kill, Betsy comes in trying to clean it up. But from here, because Gambit took so much damage under the tower as well, or well, from the one-on-one beforehand, they end up losing on the trade. They're going to get a top turret, or close to it.
Oh, Blade of the Rune King's on Pinoy. He's chasing. Trying to set something up, they get the Ragnarok down. One thing that we did catch in that replay was the changes to Ahri in 5.3. The W, that Foxfire spinning around 30% quicker, so gets more shots off, gets more damage off, but it is a shorter range. So Betsy needs to get in much closer to his enemies, and all that free time from the Roman Febiven, Betsy's now closed out, or closed down that CS gap.
And talking about the 5.3 changes to Ahri, also really highlights why Fnatic put so much focus on the blue buff. Because the W, also the Q from Ahri, cost more mana as well. So she really needs the blue buff in this matchup, and it's just been denied from Betsy. But he has now, as you just said here, caught up in farm. Second dragon being started again. Fnatic's dual lane is still in the top side. Eddie had already recalled and would be nearby in case there was a fight. So there's going to be another dragon for Gambit. 2-0. And once again, they've only invested one pink ward, that's 100 gold, on getting two dragons.
So Fnatic will answer back by securing the first tower of the game. 500 gold down against their opponents, but in a good position. Gambit now somewhat aggressive. They're caught out in the jungle. Eddie, can he land the Dark Binding? Chilling Smite comes out for Reignover. Reignover's dodged one, he's dodged two, he's dodged three, he can't dodge them all. Does get caught out. Gambit secure a kill. Now Cabochon, they've stunned that Febavin. That's two quick kills as the death mark is down, but it's not going to be enough. Gambit have got a minion line pushing up behind them, and they may want to commit to the tower. Huni is looking for a chunk of Gambit to take out, but decides against it, and Pinoy is now joining the fight. This is a 5v3, and they're going for the tower.
Again, that was just a really, really good play by Gambit. After the take, the Dragon hit, they still noted Yellowstar and still back going to top side. Huni actually caught out here.
Oh, he's in so much trouble. We do see him going down. Just a second, it's the rend that works. Gambit, they've done it again. They do manage to take a tower in reply. That aggressive move through the jungle was fantastic. They catch Fnatic out and they take a tower.
Again, it's just a great power play because they know Yellowstar and Steelbike were on the top side of the map, so they could move into the jungle, place a few deep wards. They saw Reignover move by, saying, okay, we're already here with so many members. We had Pinoy running from the top lane as well. We can take a fight, create a few picks, get a mid lane tower as well. Just such a good setup by Gambit, knowing where Fnatic were with their players and how to take advantage of it. And now we're going to get another fight for this blue buff. Well, we're going to get Fnatic to take it, I guess.
Yeah, it's something that we do have to highlight. If anybody was watching the Unicorns of Love versus HTK game yesterday, Unicorns hit their power spikes with the Trinity Forces, and they didn't necessarily use them. They didn't go aggressive. You look at Gambit with their Hourglasses with the Blade of the Ruined King, they went aggressive. They looked for an opportunity to take advantage of where they are in the game. What I need to see from Gambit in this matchup is a more concise rotation game. Because when they ran their double AD comp with limited forms of engage yesterday, they weren't really able to push those side lanes. And they do have a good position, they've got a strong lead, they need to try to push it out today.
Yeah, I talked to Gambit after the game and they said, we know we could have done more in the mid game, but we just waited for those five dragons, we played it safe against all the wave 10. Oh, Febivin!
The charm hits, Betsy wants blood! He's gonna chase out, Spirit Dash is not gonna be enough, but he gets some damage onto Febivin. Febivin's just gonna use that shadow to get away. Will it secure a tower? Support is here for Gambit. It looks to be the case.
Gambit needs some wave in the mid lane, though. Diamond. The might actually end up trading turrets.
Well, we'll see if this works out. Tower's going to fall. We'll catch a glimpse of the mid lane in a moment. So Gambit, they do get one. They will lose one in reply. Even trade, but Fnatic are still pushing.
Won't really be able to get too much. Hurricane is completed for Pinoy. He has some wave 10. Oh, Diamond is coming in behind him.
Well, let's see what he can do. Void Rush is out. Doesn't connect
Look at
with
Kennen
the
as well.
Knockup. Cabochard looking for a fight. There's no teleport available. Fnatic may
That's
make it out. That's the flash into Sicing Maelstrom. They've stunned up two members. Yellowstar is down. We're going to see Reignover unable to be crowd controlled thanks to that Ragnarok. But the flash charm. Betsy hits it on the millisecond. Double kill for Pinoy. Gambit are playing flawlessly. That was a beautiful flash charm from Betsy.
Everything here from Gambit was great. They take the bot lane turret, knowing they had ulti from Diamond to come up to the mid lane here, chase for the kills, and yeah, Cabochard moving ahead of Huni down to join the fight, flashing in, and so many nice plays. Betsy as well. This Baron, however, is a bit risky. They're going for Huni instead.
Edward got lobbed in, as is his fate. Huni dropped once more. Rend is up, will be available in a second. Pinoy looking for the stacks. Deathmark goes out, they trade one for one as Febivin is going to continue running. That ends up being a two for one trade in this particular fight, and Febivin's doing work. Diamond digs a hole under the Raptors, and Lantern from Yellowstar. The fight was so extended, Yellowstar could respawn, but the Baron didn't fall.
Baron's still alive, you're only 20 minutes in. There's been a lot of action in this game here. Gambit with the two kills first, started it with just basically waiting for Fnatic to walk in to try and stop them to take another fight. But look here, notice how Cabochard again, he's one step ahead of Huni, gonna join in first, he has flash ready. That's such a nice setup. Yellowstar will go down early, and we can see the rest of Gambit just follow up. Betsy as well, wait for this ulti to run out from Reignover, and then flash charm. There we go, flash charm into him, another kill.
That was just gorgeous. A really, really decisive play from Gambit. I do think we also need to give some praise to Fnatic. Yes, they gave up more kills, but they prevented that Baron going down. That could have been the wave-pushing nail in the coffin. If Gambit could secure it, Fnatic, they did prevent it.
We've really seen this Kennen pick here pay off for Cabochard, because he's always been able to be one step ahead of Huni. So he's actually been there for the fight itself, where Huni hasn't really have too much of an impact. He's been shut down in the laning phase quite a bit. Righteous Glory for him. So again, he's going to add in some more utility for his team, but it's going to make him weaker instead of going for that Rod of Ages, and the lack of magic damage can still be a problem for them. and obviously also for Pinoy now. QSS third item, gonna eliminate the ulti from Zed, gonna make it really, really tough for Fnatic to ever get to him when he also has a black shield for himself. A BT might come in later, so he has the shield and the extra lifesteal as well for him. So it's gonna be very, very tough to shut down Pinoy.
We're about to see Pinoy in action.
He's just pulling Eddie
again. Hurricane, chilling smite comes out.
There's Eddie.
He's gonna lob Eddie. Eddie what? Unable to knock up Rain over because of the Ragnarok.
Ah, right.
And he does escape. We did see a teleport from Cabochard. Fnatic are split up. I got your back here, Deficio. Don't worry.
It looked very weird because it's like.
It hit, but it didn't
hit.
Knock
and
him
then
up.
He got knocked. Kind of knocked Eddie back instead.
Let's see what happens. Fnatic have grouped up in the top lane. Despite the fact that Gambit started the fight, it looks like Gambit are going to be happy to trade what appears to be the dragon for a tower, but they want the fight. Death Sentence connects on Eddie. Yellow Star's gone in, but he's left the rest of his team. Steelback's caught out, and Cabochard has soloed in a 1v2. Yellow Star gets dropped by the rest of Gambit's support, and now Huni is in full retreat. He's
going
to flash over the wall. Pinoy fails the pierce, not able to follow it up. But Gambit did get the dragon at the cost of a tower, and they did secure two kills. It may not be over yet, Deficio. Hold that thought. Prey Seeker goes out. Diamond
is coming as well.
Looking for Febivin. Ragnarok goes out, but the damage from Betsy is large. He does not have Spirit Rush, but he does have Exhaust. The knockup lands on Febivin. Febivin goes in with the Deathmark. Hourglass early from Cabochard will dodge the damage. Febivin is down. Huni is down. Gambit 16-5. They are looking to go 5-0.
And Fnatic is normally the team who plays so well together. 5 versus 5, but Gambit in this game here just always one step ahead to take the right fights, to catch them out of positions again and again and again. Whenever Fnatic tries to push a tower, Gambit comes in from the side, gets a kill, gets a dragon, 3 dragons for 0 as well for them. Yellowstar is the only guy who's trying to stop it. Now Steelback joining.
Oh, gonna
pull him
in. Pinoy saves Eddie. Pinoy's going ham. Rend is available. He's going to put some damage down, but yes, Baron not secured. Keep a close eye on those player cams. We saw Febivin's face a moment ago, he is not looking like a happy camper. While we've got a moment to breathe, well, we don't have a moment to breathe, there's the replay.
So again, yeah, Gambit is fine trading Dragon for Tower because they already have 2-0, so they're going towards that fifth Dragon point now. And notice after the fight top lane, look at your minimap, Cabochard already running down to join in, so Fnatic know, okay, we're not going to be able to run away here. Febivin, he's going to die for sure, so they go for the fight instead. And that just ends up really backfiring for them. Now, beautiful stun by Diamond, Febivin goes down after popped his ulti, first hourglass, and Yellowstar's gonna die as well.
Well, that was easy peasy. Put an Empire's Gambit get a kill. Betsy, in his second game on the LCS stage, going 6-0-6. Keep in mind, he didn't get a blue buff. Keep in mind how much pressure Febivin put on him. And he's really stepping up. We did see Gambit look to secure that red buff, which they did. Fnatic have not got wave clear in this middle lane. Gambit are taking their fourth tower. Zero opposition.
Gambit is really playing well with this skirmish, like pick comp kind of team. Like it's a bit of everything for Gambit in this case, except for like a real tank. But they're playing so well around it because they keep creating these picks onto Fnatic and punish Fnatic for overextending in any lane. And then they transition that into towers and dragons. Again, 3 dragons to 0, 26 minutes in. That's scary because suddenly Fnatic now have that ticking time bomb where they're forced to fight. And at this point, in a straight up 5-on-5, your Maokai is not tank enough to do anything. Your Olaf as well. Yes, you might be able to single out one target, but that's going to be it. Febivin doesn't have a target. QSS on Pinoy, double hourglass as well for the 2 AP carries. Who is he going to kill?
Nobody at this stage, Deficio, because Gambit have just got... They put together a team comp that they're playing off. Febivin, you're dead. Lantern is up. He's got away, but is taken out between Eddie and Rend. They get themselves their 18th kill. I do have to highlight the fact that Huni has been absolutely nullified. He did not get his hands on Lissandra. He did not get his hands on Rumble, both banned away. And when you think of him playing any other champions, the Gnar played it once, uninspiring. Now he's playing Maokai. Huni on tanks, not necessarily the greatest of performances.
I do have to say in this game, Gambit has done a great job actually shutting him down as well. And that's one of the reasons he's not really been able to get going on the Maokai. But yeah, you are right. He's been looking a lot better on these AP carries instead for him. But Gambit is overall just... They do such a good job playing around Cabochard and his strong laning phase. Really make sure he can always get... Once they swap back to the real lanes. Because remember, the lane swap itself, Huni was running with Rain over to take the buffs away. He took the first blue buff from Diamond, then he took their own blue buff for Fnatic themselves. Meanwhile, Cabochard was just sitting in the lane, one versus two farming, nothing was stopping him, and that's again why he got such a massive lead.
It's true. Even if Huni was playing a different champion, the way Gambit reacted to the lane swap and the way they took advantage of Fnatic's over-aggression on the 3-buff, almost 4-buff, it was Gambit then pulled themselves up. Take a look at your minimap. There are deep wards and tunnels slowly being cleared out by Fnatic, but it's Gambit that have had the vision in the jungle, and those sentinels giving more. Reignova just dodges a bullet.
And this is a thing Gambit didn't do yesterday. Start baiting that Baron. As soon as you know you're stronger and you can establish that vision control, you go towards that Baron and take control of the area, so you force Fnatic to come and face check you. Yesterday, it took a long time for them to do it. Now, big change, double Oracle Lens coming in for them as well to really deny vision around it. And we just see them move always back in towards. They want to make sure the Fnatic can never fully leave this area, because then suddenly the Baron will go down. Remember the Rend stacks from a Kalista.
The decisive play from Gambit. It is day and night. Yesterday, it was Cabochon and Diamond that got them through that laning phase and set Gambit up with a double AD comp in just, you know, fantastic fashion. But today, Gambit are pushing the map. They've got absolute dragon control. Another one spawning in 40 seconds. Their vision has been great, and they've not been caught out of position. And Gambit is making sure they're punishing Fnatic's movements.
Exactly. Gambit has outplayed Fnatic in terms of teamwork, which normally never happens. Fnatic beat SK through the teamwork yesterday. And now Gambit really showing, well, we can do it as well. We can run as a unit. We can create these picks here. We can take full advantage of you if you ever split up on the map, like they've done with this very, very mobile and very damage-heavy comp. If you get caught out, you will die very fast, and we've seen it time and time again.
Let's see if Fnatic decide to pick a fight on Dragon number 4. They've got a lot of armor. Two Frozen
Hearts. They want to trade for Baron.
Righteous Glory. You've got some damage between Febiven and Steelback, but they have targets to go through. Let's see if they get the trade.
Diamond should go straight to the Baron itself. He should never have joined for this dragon here. Kalista can take it on her own. She has lifesteal already. She has to rend. So just let Pinoy solve this dragon, and then you make sure you can stop Fnatic from starting. This what Gambit is doing. Fnatic had to back away. 4 dragons to 0 now. 36 minutes in, and we're going to have that 5th dragon for Gambit.
Gambit have got positioning on the inhibitor turret. Fnatic want to knock on their door and
when
go
they got
through
the
gate. So we'll be able to respond quickly enough. We've got some wave clear, but Huni, he's decided to engage. This is one of those terrible flanking guerrilla warfare moments we saw from JWoww yesterday. Huni. Oh, Huni.
Oh, Huni. Not in his best game for sure. Now simply opens up for Gambit to actually go for this tower. They don't have any minions. Look at the side lanes. They're very far away, especially the bottom lane. It's not going to push for Gambit at all. So they have to align these 6 minions and the Brave Cannon coming in.
Well, let's see what Gambit can do. They've caught Reignover. He's already thrown down a Ragnarok. That's an aggressive dive. Cabochon forced to use that Hourglass. Betsy gets one on the board as Cabochon is taken down in reply. Now, Steelback. What can he do to wave clear? The answer is nothing, because Gambit have taken the turret, they've taken the inhibitor. They will be ecstatic with that trade. Super minions barreling down
Huni
the middle
again.
Lane. Now Huni, oh, you're on the wrong side of town, buddy. We do see Fate's Call throwing, knocking him up in the air. Huni is gonna get dropped again. Put some CC down, but that was a poor call. And you can see big sigh from Huni in your player cam. Really not on the same page as the rest of the team.
No, exactly. 2 times in a row now where he tries to flank, and it's pretty obvious the team is not in a position to really fight with him. Again, Fnatic, though, knowing again with his 4 dragons, being so far behind in gold, you're going to have to pull out some desperation plays. Baron is one of them, but Diamond stayed. We'll make sure they can start it and rush it. So now, again, it's all about Gambit. They can wait for next dragon to spawn if they want to. They already have the inhibitor down. Then go for a push. They can take the Baron first, even bait it, force Fnatic to come in again. Face check them, move them out of their own base itself. There's so many options for Gambit here.
Well, Gambit are set poised to take their 5th win in a row against Fnatic, the number 2 team in the league. And if you step back and you look at the big picture, what this game reminds me of is watching H2K last week. H2K led into the week. They had some scrappy wins. They had some, you know, games that went long and they had to dig deep. Gambit have been in a similar position throughout their wins, and this game is now just great decision-making. Objective after objective. Vision into jungle invade, into lane invade. With 32 minutes on the clock, and Gambit have got super minions and near perfect map control. It is just great to see the growth of the league.
It's almost been like an old M5 game, honestly, where you get all the dragons on the side of Gambit, and you keep always looking at where the enemy is, and if you see them, okay, they're on the top side, we're gonna invade your jungle instead, ward it up completely, and again, look for these picks here, constantly punish the enemy team for being out of position for Gambit. I like the style for them. Really suits them well.
Yeah, I agree.
Keep creating these picks and going for Huni, it's not the first time.
No, it's not. The lantern's there this time around. Soul Shackle's unable to root the tree in place. Gambit, they've got a little bit of pressure in the jungle. They steal themselves a buff. The one thing that we do need to note for Fnatic, they're looking, they might get caught out of position here. This is so scary.
Oh, Rain over here has the lantern.
Okay, so yellow.
Only problem for Gambit here is they don't have any pink wards around this Baron itself, so they can't really deny too much vision, but instead they can just teleport in.
They don't need vision when they can just engage. They've TP'd onto Fnatic. Eddie's gonna be taken out by Febervin, but is it enough? Febervin in full retreat, as is Rainover. Keep your eyes on Pinoy. He's chasing, he's dashing, he's hopping. Ren is available, he's taken out. You steal back and Yellow Star dropped. I'm at a loss for words, DeFicio. Gambit get 3-2. Little bit messy to clean up.
If Diamond can stop the recalls here, then Gambit can finish the game. He's looking for Febervin, he's standing there recalling. He won't get to stop him, but he's delayed them long enough. There should be at least one inhibitor turret.
So, Nexus turret is down. Pinoy. He's gonna lifesteal up off the minions before he backs away. Again, that fight didn't exactly go the right way. Fnatic got a lot of damage down quickly. And this Gambit weren't necessarily as clumped. He did end up coming off a little worse for it, but a turret means Gambit's still in the lead. 11,000 gold in the lead.
Right, Teleport coming in, cover shot. He can't really find a target for himself because he gets locked down by Huni. And then you actually see Febivin jumping Eddie, get the first kill, and there's a lot of damage now. This is a good fight for Fnatic, except for the fact that Pinoy, he didn't get dropped. Nobody can get to him and kill him. And now, on this Kalista, when he can just keep auto-attacking with this much attack speed, get the rinse off here, get the reset on it as well, he could clean up the fight. Dragon 1 minute is gonna be the target for Gambit. Just get a few pink wards now, set everything up around it. You don't care if Fnatic goes for Baron, let them have it. You take this fifth dragon, then you just push down the base. That's enough for you.
And the way Gambit have played with their very, very aggressive engages, if they get that fifth dragon and double the stats, 12% AD and AP at this point, that's the makings of a guaranteed teamfight win. Diamond playing so aggressively with just the support of Edward, bullying Fnatic through their jungle. 30 seconds until Dragon spawns. You can feel the tension as Fnatic are grouped up looking for a fight. Charm connects. Heavens to Betsy, that damage
that was
huge.
The tank.
2,000 hit points just shredded away there or thereabouts from Huni.
This is going to make it nearly impossible for Fnatic to do anything. If you can't even send in Huni to buy time for your carries to do anything in a fight, well, then you might as well just back away and not risk being aced at this dragon and end up losing the game.
No teleport for Huni either, so he can't back off and...
He got to heal a little bit on the minions, though. He got to heal a little bit.
Let's see what he can do. Still around 50% of his HP available. There is vision in the pit for Fnatic.
Going in.
Righteous Glory's been activated. Huni's looking for a target, but Gambit have peeled back, have peeled away, have managed to peel Fnatic apart. Rainover, no Ragnarok yet. He does decide to go in. Let's look for Pinoy. Dark Binding connects on Febervin. Edward, what have you done to save this fight? We do see them Gambit in retreat, slicing Maelstrom to zone up as best they can. Pinoy is running rampage through the side lanes. We do see Febervin trying to get out, but he goes down. Deathmark does secure one. Triple kill for Cabochard. Dragon number 5 for Gambit. DeFicio, this is game.
This should be game at least. They're going actually for the Baron itself. Diamond even had a tunnel over there. Can start it, they have the Baron buff, might even get a kill on Yellowstar.
Has he got Yellowstar? It's gonna take the tunnel. The Flay comes out. Diamondback is back. Diamondback?
Diamondback is back.
See, I forgot a word. Diamond is back. End of story. Gambit, Dragon number 5, Baron number 1. And a just dominating victory. These team fights have become a little scary for Gambit, but it doesn't matter.
As you notice how Gambit, as to see the Righteous Lord being popped, they just back away. They kite around here, try and land a little bit of poke, or see if they can get the dragon low enough to use the rent from Kalista. Here's a little problem for Cabochard. He gets CC'd, so he doesn't get to use his ulti before the hourglass. So he's actually lacking a lot of damage for him. But Pinoy again, notice his HP. He's barely getting hit, so he can just jump around. Febervin can't even go for him due to the QSS, and therefore Gambit can still clean up the fights. Poor little Cabochard has to die in the end, though.
I absolutely love the fact that Eddie managed to land that Dark Binding on Febervin right at the beginning. The amount of time that it bought Gambit just allowed them to chase. We do see movement speed. That's a very quick Gambit squad. They've got empowered minions, they've got empowered champions. They've got another inhibitor down. Look at the minion waves. It is pushing against them in two lanes, but Gambit, they don't give a monkeys because they're grouping on the Nexus turret. They're going to put some damage down. Hooney's trying to catch out. Teleport was used, and Eddie predicts it. Look at Febivan. He's low. He's already forced back. He's forced out of the fight.
Well, they can go back, get your home guards. Fnatic just needs to go get home guards here. Take a bit of damage, try and reset as soon as they actually can, get full HP, and then go back into the fight. They have to win this here, otherwise Gambit Gaming are going to look so good in.
I don't think they can. Cabochard's gone in. This is the fight that wins Gambit their fifth game in a row. The Nexus turret is falling. The Nexus is down. Gambit is back.
We heard Diamond saying the feature beforehand. It's time for Gambit to get on a real long winning streak. Obviously not a losing streak, a winning streak for Gambit. Wait to ruin the moment.
DeFizio, I am stunned.
5 wins in a row now.
I am
Gambit is
stunned.
On a fantastic winning streak. And every game they play, they just look better and better.
It's more than that. This is the best game Gambit has played in 2015.
Yeah, for sure.
There is no doubt about it. For anybody that was doubting their ability, which includes me, if this is what Gambit can reach, if this is what Gambit can do, we need to see this more often.
It was just fantastic to see how they always knew what to do whenever Fnatic tried to make a play. Gambit would always say, okay, either we're going to go 5 minutes and kill you, or we can just send 3 guys to stop you from pushing, and then the other two can take a dragon. Again, they got every single dragon in this game, 5-0. Not a problem for them at all. They were just always, again, a step ahead of Fnatic and outplayed them in terms of teamwork, which is so weird. And Hooney's luckily still smiling a little bit.
Yeah, this mixed reactions from the Fnatic camp when we caught them on camera. When you've been thoroughly beaten like this, I guess the best thing to do is step back and just realize where it went wrong.
Yeah,
because
for sure.
From the very early game, Fnatic had a clear strategy in the jungle, but Gambit just replied and their team fights were just, they were borderline rude because they just kept jumping on Fnatic over and over. That was a very exciting game to watch. 33-9. Before I give this back to DeFizio, Betsy, heavens Betsy, 10-0-13. His team had 33 kills. He was involved in 23. No deaths. He did on Ahri, hate to say this, what Nick was unable to do throughout the course of their previous games. That was a phenomenal performance.
It was, and compared to his performance yesterday, the first game he played on stage, clearly some nerves.
Yeah.
Or maybe he just couldn't make the same plays on an Ezreal compared to the Ahri here. I really like him as a player. He has great mechanics. We've seen it already. Not afraid to jump in as well, despite only playing 2 games now in the LCS. But for Gambit, honestly, the way they managed to punish Fnatic for putting so much focus on the buffs, which again doesn't really deny too much XP from your jungler, allowed again Cabochard just to do whatever he wants. Pinoy had a free time as well in the lane swap. Once they actually swap back, the two main lanes, the two side lanes, they were ahead in farm for Gambit's side. And they stayed ahead in farm all game long. And they were really also the 2 carries together with, I guess we can add in Betsy, of course, the 3 carries then for them. And they just ran this team fight or this team comp where there was so much CC and, again, mobility coming in. You had the Talisman completed for Eddie to really boost up everyone so they could keep forcing the fights on Fnatic. And as you mentioned earlier, double Hourglass. There you have your armor already against the Graves and the Zed as the 2 damage dealers coming in from Fnatic side. As soon as Fnatic fell behind, they just couldn't take down any targets fast enough except for the support or maybe Cabochard after the fight was already over and they'd already lost.
Yeah, the one thing that does stand out to me is early game, the first 30 minutes was clearly in Gambit's favor. There was those 2 team fights that were just a little messy in the middle lane and then around Dragon a little later. But Fnatic had moments where they could have done things. But unfortunately, they'd given up too much too early. And this is what we said in Picks and Bans. If you're going to run a heavy AD composition, you can't afford to let your opponents itemize against you. And unfortunately, it did happen. So before we carry on, we actually throw it over to our analyst, as they are joined by a few members of Gambit Gaming. So let's hand it over to them for a closer look into that 5th straight win.
Thanks, Quick Chat. We're here with Diamond and Pinoy after that stellar performance versus Fnatic. 5-game winning streak. The first thing I got to ask you, Diamond, what changed from before the winning streak and right after?
I think the only thing that has changed is like our practice. We just got our normal internet. We started to practice really good, and then Jordan arrived and helped us really bigly out with our fails and stuff to fix them. And now we're improving day by day. As I said, like 2 weeks or 1 week before, we're improving. So we're beating more and more guys.
Okay, Pino, I have a little question for you. Kalista, it felt like pretty much the perfect champion to have against our team comp. So many low-range characters, Zed, Maokai, Olaf. After you got such a good early game, how confident were you in your ability to just carry this game?
I felt really confident because we have a strong front line, or I know that my cannon will zone their back line, so the only thing I have to worry about is Olaf and Maokai, which Kalista is good against, and they were stacking armor, so I got an early last whisper, so I didn't feel pressure any in the team fights at all.
Yeah, it is very good. Okay, I got another question for Diamond here. Your level 1, it was a bit scary for me to see. You did get invaded on your blue and it got stolen. You tried to invade their blue but got first blood. But still, afterwards, you managed to still get such good map control, such good flanks off. How did you manage to make that happen?
I think it was all because they tried to push their advantage further on and came to our red and just gave us 2 free kills, and that really just let me came back into the game. And then I was just so ahead that I could buy, like, not a lot of wards, but I could apply so much pressure on the map that they couldn't handle it. And if I wouldn't give some crabs to Yellow Star, then it would be even better.
But it was very good as was. We saw you going for the Skirmisher Saber again, even though the first times you ran it on Jarvan in the beginning of the season wasn't your thing, but here on Rek'Sai it really worked. Explain us why.
Because Rek'Sai is much better champion than any other one. Like Nidalee and Rek'Sai are pretty much like really good, and other junglers are like poor, weak.
So those are your top 2 picks yesterday on Nidalee. Also fantastic game. Talk us through the shot calling in your team with Betsy coming in. Tabs pointed out that maybe with Nick going you would have some trouble there, but Betsy stepping up and it seemed like you guys knew exactly where you were going on the map and someone had a close rein on that, Pinoy.
So Nick, after our losing streak, we decided to put a main shot caller, and that was practicing with Nick as the shot caller. But after he's got away, Edward and Kabushard are more in the control, and Edward is stepping up really huge in our comps. So he's like taking the role of Nick until he comes back.
I see. Talk me through, playing with Betsy a little more, because yesterday he had a good game, but you were carrying on Nidalee a lot, so the team was kind of going on that. And then today you're like, Betsy, you're going up against Febivin's Zed, his best champion, Radder, and a very bad matchup for you. So how did he react to that, because he stepped up to the plate?
Betsy is playing really well. I wasn't even afraid of him doing like some poor stuff against Febivin, because I think he can like stay that lane 50-50. Either he will stay safe or he will like dominate Febivin. He stayed safe, then they gave him advantage, then he went just like bottom lane and almost killed that 1v1 and kept doing that thing for all the game. So I was really confident in that guy, even though he's not like talking much when he's playing, but I guess he's a really great player, and I'm glad that we had him as a sub.
Yeah. He did hit those charms when he needed to. Let's actually take a look at a team fight of one of the team fights in the end of the game, where Fnatic is strong and tanky, but you guys managed to pull it out. Pinoy, walk us through it.
Yeah, so we Kabushard is calling that he will flank them, and so we just tried to fight them. Our focus is on Zed because he ulted our cannon. I believe. And then we're just trying to kill whoever is like close. We want to fight to our advantage. Like as long as the fight go, we win the game, because Kalista is just stacking the rent, and we just clean up here. We're not continuing the replay.
Well, from there, you won the next fight, and then you won the game. How come that in this one, you guys were also very self-confident in closing the game out? We saw in your other wins, also nice wins, but it took a little while to close it out and didn't work that well. Why in this one, it was just straightforward?
I think it's mostly because their team composition was lack of wave clear. And like when we were having poor experience of finishing the game. It wasn't because our fail. It was like against Xero for Azir or Champions, which just like clearing the waves really fast. And even then, you have five dragons and Baron. You can't even rush Azir because he doesn't provide you any tankiness. So he will just one-shot you as always. Mm-hmm. And he was really strong back then. That's pretty much why we closed that game faster than previous ones.
Yeah, and what a victory versus Fnatic. And it's typical EU LCS. Everybody's beating everybody. Diamond and Pinoy, can you give me maybe your opinion on how the standings are evolving and why you guys have found new life in Light and teams like Elements and Rocket don't seem to find their swing?
You have something to
say? I think Elements is like they won last year, and I think it's not as motivating because you can't stay at the top all the time, while the new teams with new rosters and new members coming in, they have so much fresh blood, and it's not okay to say they want it more, but I think they want it more because they're just enjoying the new environment, playing in the LCS professionally.
Diamond, anything to add?
I don't know, like Elements are having big problems with their roster, as I see. Fnatic are playing really good. They're just losing because of opponents finding their weaknesses and playing on it. And like our good team SK, they only lost to Fnatic. I don't know why.
And in the end, Gambit's on a 5-game winning streak, so it's all good for you guys. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
All right, coming up in just a few minutes is a matchup between two squads who are hungry for wins, Rocket and Elements. Stay tuned and see who starts their climb in the tables in just a few minutes.
Who need?
They are a crazy boy.
What?
They are crazy boy.
What?
All
my fans!
All crazy boy.
Oh my god! You must shut up.
Dodged one, he's dodged two, he's dodged three, he can't dodge them all. Does get caught out. Gambit secure a kill, now Cabochon. They've stunned that Fervivin.
Come on, go on set. Finish him.
Finish that. Nice!
They don't need vision when they can just engage. They've TP'd onto Fnatic. Eddie's going to be taken out by Fervivin, but is it enough? This is the fight that wins Gambit their fifth game in a row. The Nexus turret is falling. Gambit is back!